Y'all, thank you very much. We have a lot of information. We'll try to get right to it. We'll start with, this is Josie McDaniel will be signing. Holly May is watching. Chaplain Jeff Shealy, please.
Well, good afternoon, my fellow citizens. At this time, I would invite us to remember the second of our two state mottos. While I breathe, I hope. So whatever your background or your faith tradition, whatever your convictions, I call on us to pause and to breathe and to trust that wherever there is breath, there is life. And wherever there is life, there will always be hope. And I humbly ask you now to allow me to pray for all of us. Lord God, the tragedy and chaos of life causes us to be afraid and to despair and to grieve. We lift before you these fears, our worries, and our grief in lament and call upon you to hear us. Hear us and help us. Bring us together and unite us so that we use our resources for those who are in need and alleviate the suffering of our citizens. Through our collective efforts, bring justice and create peace. Calm our weary souls and inspire us to the ultimate task of the human experience, the task of service. For there in those places where we serve one another, your breath of life is at work to bring healing and restoration to all people. To you, O God, be all the glory and honor. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Chaplain. Just a few introductory remarks. We do have some numbers. You may have remember some of these on Friday. These are outages, meters. We have about 3 million electric meters in the state. On Friday, we had 1,300,000 out. Saturday, 1,200,000. Sunday, had 904,209. And Monday, we had 745,593. So it's going down steadily. As of Sunday, Dominion, to break those numbers out a little bit, had 99,677 meters still out. Duke had 468,647. Santee Cooper, which provides through transmission, their transmission is restored, but the co-ops had 177,269 still out. So we're making progress. Unfortunately, we've now gone up to 29 deaths as of this morning related to the storm. And we ask you to keep those families and loved ones in our prayers. Progress is slow. Again, as you know, one of the things that's slowing us down is the choke points. We got all these electrical lines down. The soil was wet. The trees went over. The winds were adequate to knock the trees down. They knocked the power lines down, so we have power lines tangled up with trees and limbs, and it is dangerous to go in and try to clear that out yourself if you are not a power lineman. That is why the power companies must go in first and assess that before the chainsaw crews can get in. And we have lots of chainsaws ready to go, and more are coming. In fact, as General McCarty will explain, we got more guardsmen going out. We started off with, I think it was about 600. By the end of the 500, by the end of this day, we'd be well up to 670. And we have about 140, another company of 140 coming on sometime late today. So we're ramping up all over the state. A couple of things to mention. We ask people not to listen to rumors. Don't get your information from these unofficial sources, because 99% of the time they're wrong. And there were a couple of them that were circulating recently and causing fear and concern among people in Columbia, and that is that the Columbia water system was going out, the wastewater as well as the drinking water. Well, none of that's true. It was stated that everyone was evacuating the facility and all that, And I think the mayor and others had a press conference earlier today to knock down those rumors. I spoke to the mayor a minute ago. He says he thinks they got those rumors knocked down, but there'll be another one coming right behind it before long. So please get your information from official sources. And also, the another one, was there no power company presence in Greenville? Well, if you go on the internet and look at the pictures, don't listen to the words, maybe, but you'll see there are power companies all over, trucks all over, as well as people in Greenville. One other thing is this disaster relief. We're getting a lot of calls wanting to know why this county or that county has not been included in the disaster relief. That is because under the federal procedure, although we got the declaration to provide funds for disaster relief, the counties themselves must send in the information here for us to transmit it to FEMA. It doesn't work any other way. And if incorrect or fraudulent information is sent in, that is a federal crime. So we cannot send in information. Director Stinson can explain this again in more detail, but we can't send it in unless it is sent in to us, and it's got to be accurate. And most of the counties have not sent anything in to us to send in. So county officials, once you get the information, it takes a little while to assess the damages, but once we get that once you get that information, and then we have that information, we get it right in. Again, progress is slow due to that choke point that I mentioned. Still a good warning, don't go near those down lines. Don't take a chance. Don't put any sort of equipment in the house running. Don't have your generator going. We've had people die because of that, at least one. Also, we don't think that we're going to have any unusual flooding. We think that the flooding that we will be having, some of the rivers have already crested and are going down. Others are still building up. In Columbia here, the Congaree will be, I don't think it's crested yet. Maybe it's about to crest. We'll hear about that in a minute. But we don't expect any downriver unusual water going up outside of the floodplain. Also, I mentioned the National Guard. We are fully conversant in dealing with FEMA. We got a call, I think I told you before, Deanie Criswell had called several days ago. President Biden called late yesterday afternoon, and we have embedded with us Brett Howard with FEMA. And so we are working that and getting whatever we're entitled to have or allowed to have. And we've got the whole team on the field. Everybody that is available, even some that usually don't go out in the field, they're all out in the field now. And so we have a great team and a great, because of experience, we got a great working relationship with all these different companies and entities, as well as the various counties. So we're making progress, but again, it's going to take a while because of this situation where the power lines are down. They're tangled up in the trees, and that's slowing us down. That is the main hindrance to getting everything going again. John Quirillo.
Thank you, Governor. John Quirillo with the National Weather Service. So I just want to address some of the concerns the governor brought up with rumors about flooding in Columbia. So understandably, the river flooding in Columbia is an area of concern, especially with people making comparisons to 2015 floods. Well, there is some flooding to homes and roads adjacent to the Broad and Congaree Rivers, such as what we're currently seeing in the Riverland Park neighborhood in Casey, for example. The good news is that the rivers, like the governor had mentioned, are cresting now in the Columbia area. So for reference, the Congaree River at Columbia appears to have crested at 30.58 feet late this morning. This is the ninth highest crest on record and about 1.2 feet below what was observed on the river during the 2015 floods. I think it's important to stress that we don't anticipate any additional significant flooding to occur. Other areas away from the banks of the Broad and Congaree Rivers that experienced flooding in 2015 will not see impacts. Flooding in 2015 was so severe because it was not just the river flooding, it was also torrential rainfall, which breached dams and brought creeks and streams out of their banks. Also, I have some good news concerning the Watery River at Camden. That river crested late last evening, and floodwaters will continue to recede, falling below major flood stage tomorrow. The floodwater will slowly work their way down toward the coast, with major flooding expected on the Santee River in Jamestown by Thursday. Moderate flooding is also possible on parts of the PD. Impacts will be limited, though, to areas more flood-prone right along the river. We also want to urge everyone living along, especially the Congaree and Broad Rivers, to listen to the advice of local officials and remind everyone to avoid driving on any eroded floodways. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you. Andrew Bateman, Director, Office of Regulatory Staff.
Thank you, Governor. Andrew Bateman, the South Carolina Office of Regulatory Staff. We continue to communicate frequently and work with our utility partners, our federal partners, and other state agencies to help restore power throughout the state. We understand the situation is ongoing. I'll briefly summarize some of the outages that the governor mentioned earlier. The total statewide outages at this point are 745,593. The top three impacted counties are Greenville County with just over 200,000 outages, Spartanburg County with just over 154,000 outages, and Anderson County with just over 72,000 outages. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you, sir. President Keller Kasam, Dominion Energy.
Keller Kasam, Dominion Energy. Just some quick numbers. Totally impact customers on our system now, 440,000. Peak outage, 386,000. So that tells you some customers have been out more than once. I'm delighted to say that we finally broke through 100,000 out. We're at 95,000 out currently. Biggest impacted areas are here in Columbia. You know, everybody says, I don't see any line crews in my neighborhood. Well, they see them today. We tried to explain this. Transmission is substation, major taps that you see, get the commercial operations back up so people can get food, they can get gasoline. And that's the process that we've been through. Now we're in the neighborhoods today. So don't hear that anymore. Aiken, the governor was there yesterday. I was with him. That's the area that's hardest hit. In Aiken alone, general assessments indicate that we have over 1,000 broken poles in the town of Aiken alone. So it's going to be a tough recovery in that area. I just want to say that Team South Carolina extends beyond just these folks back here who help us, Chief Keel, Secretary Powell, Jimmy State, and I'd be remiss with Santee Cooper because they have come in and they offered up 143 line crews on the transmission side to assist us for mutual assistance because of the good fortune that they've had down there. The DOT has been tremendous with our crews working jointly trying to clear these roads. We make sure the lines are de-energized. They come in and provide that support. Brian Sterling, Department of Corrections, has got some chainsaw crews out there for us. And the things that mean the most of all the kind gestures that are shown to our linemen who are out there, no sleep, sweating. We try to keep them fed, but when they go in to get a drink at a restaurant, there are people all over that are buying their lunch, that are buying them food. That just tells you how wonderful and how blessed we are to live in this Palmetto State. And then Chapin High School, shout out to them. The young people at Chapin High School, they don't have class, but what they are doing is tomorrow at 9 o'clock, they're gonna feed 150 linemen, those students. So it's overwhelming. We feel so blessed in the midst of all of this difficulty that we're facing right now. But we'll get through it, we'll endure, and we'll get stronger, and it'll bring us even closer together. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you, sir. Now, State President Mike Callahan, Duke Energy.
Mike Callahan, South Carolina President, Duke Energy. Thank you, Governor, and thank you to everyone around behind me. Team South Carolina is certainly going to get through this, and I just want to express my appreciation for all of the support that we feel, as Keller talked about. So Duke Energy has made significant progress since Friday morning assessing and repairing the substantial damage to our infrastructure. I just had a briefing on that progress and some numbers for you. The number of customers without power continues to come down, now approaching about 450,000. As of yesterday afternoon, that was 530,000, so significant work there. And that compares to about 625,000 that were without power as the storm left the region on Friday. The poles, wires, and even some of the substations that make up our transmission system experience significant damage. This infrastructure must be repaired before service can be restored to neighborhoods and businesses. So for example, we had 108 transmission lines that were out of service yesterday, and we have brought back 40 of those into service today. We had 117 substations out of service yesterday, and we brought back 35 of those this morning. And to date, we have restored about 50% of the substations that were damaged by the storm. So the team is hard at work on rebuilding this infrastructure that really serves as the backbone of our system to take power that's generated at our plants and ultimately deliver it to our customers. In terms of resources, we have nearly 6,000 skilled line workers and support personnel on the ground now in the upstate and working strategically as we assign these workers where they are needed most to restore power in an efficient and safe manner. Yesterday, we began sharing with our customers that we expect to have power restored to the vast majority of our customers no later than Friday evening, with the exception of areas that are inaccessible or unable to receive service. And to be absolutely clear, that doesn't mean power will be out for everyone until Friday. It just means that the very last customer that we can restore might be as late as Friday night. But we'll see many customers continue to come online well before that. And the work that we are doing and will continue to do until the last customer has power takes time, as the governor said, and we appreciate the patience. We know how inconvenient this is, how disruptive this is to people's lives. I'd like to end on something that we're focused on every day at Duke Energy. Governor, you mentioned safety. We ask that all drivers in the upstate move over, slow down considerably when they see emergency service, first responders, and utility workers on the side of the road. You know, the move over laws in South Carolina are meant to protect workers, like those working to restore power, from life-threatening injuries. We also ask that members of the public avoid approaching utility workers in the field or entering their work zones as they clear debris and restore power. They have a hazardous and time-consuming job to do, and that requires their full attention to safety. So we just ask that everyone continue to support us in that effort. And thank you again.
Thank you, Mike Callahan. President and CEO Jimmy Staton, Santee Cooper.
Jimmy Staton with Santee Cooper. Our retail business, as you all know, was not part of the, we weren't in the direct line of destruction from this storm, and so we were able to restore all of that service on Friday. Our transmission system, however, was hit fairly hard, but not nearly as hard as what Duke and Dominion, the cooperatives, and several of the municipalities in the state have had to deal with. Working collaboratively with the cooperatives, we were able to get our last delivery point on our transmission system on yesterday. So our system is fully functioning now. So at Santee Cooper, our thoughts as being a part of Team South Carolina is that we have transitioned from restoration to mutual aid. And we have provided, as Keller said, we've got over 140 folks out working with municipals, working with the most hardest hit cooperatives. We've sent a couple of crews to Keller on the transmission side to help him reestablish service to those folks. So again, we are dedicated to ensuring that our team stays active as long as people are without power in South Carolina. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you, Mr. Staton. President and CEO Rob Hostetler. Central Electric Power Cooperative.
Thank you, Governor. Rob Hostetler, President of Central Electric Power Cooperative. I'm here representing all 19 electric cooperatives of South Carolina. My colleagues have done a good job talking about Helene and the devastation, the utter destruction. I thought I would focus on what makes the cooperatives unique. We serve about a third of the population, about two-thirds of the land mass. We operate in all 46 counties in the state. Our peak count of outages was 425 meters without power. Today, crews are working around the clock. People work in the evening as well. We have more than 300 additional people who have come in from outside the state to join Team South Carolina, coming from many states, through mutual aid. These people come in trained and ready to go to work. Our eastern cooperatives that weren't hit as hard are all helping the western cooperatives put power back in place. I would like to say the cavalry is here, but the cavalry continues to show up. More people are showing up every day from these states, some as far away as Kansas and Iowa. As Mike mentioned, it could be a week or more for some people to get their power back, but people will be getting power back during that time. We serve some of the most rural and remote parts of the state, and that takes time to get there. The exception being those very limited places where there just is utter destruction. This is unprecedented damage. The western side of our state saw what I call the dirty side of the hurricane. That northeastern side is where you get utter destruction. More rain, more wind, more damage. And so this is not a typical storm restoration for our state in that part of the country, that part of the state, the upper part of the state. It's a rebuild. And that's the way I'm starting to think of it. It is harder to rebuild in mountainous areas than it is where it's flat. We're still assessing damages in those areas that we cannot get to because of the thousands of trees down. But just a couple of stats. Last time I checked, more than 1,900 poles were snapped. Just for context, it takes about a four-person crew up to 4 hours to replace a single pole. So that's a lot of work to be done. Co-ops by nature are not as dense, so a few poles for us might only bring on a few meters, where a few poles in more suburban areas might bring on full neighborhoods. We are making progress. A good way to explain what all my colleagues talked about is thinking about, we deliver electrons like cars are delivered on highways and interstates. The transmission system is the interstates. The delivery points that you heard them talk about are the exits off the interstates. We depend on them, Keller from Dominion, Mike from Duke Energy, Jimmy from Santee Cooper, to get those interstates open and get the exits open so that we can go get the service on the roads that run in front of your home, in front of your communities. That's what we call distribution. That's what the co-ops do. A little bit about what our employees are doing. Every employee is working on these things in the state. It's around the clock. It is a dangerous work. As Mike said, give them space to do their jobs, offer them some breath. They live in the communities they serve. They know how important it is, electricity, to all of us every day. They get it. One good example to me that really hit home was a crew member at Black River Electric out of Sumter, South Carolina. Unfortunately, their home burned to the ground, total loss on Friday. That person was back to work on the weekend to help other people. And I just think that's amazing. We get it as society, electricity is important. The few people, and really multiple people, that are asking, what can we do to help? And I would tell you, what you can do to help is, one, be safe yourselves. Please be safe. Offer some patience to the employees that are out working. Give them space to do their work. I've had employees ask me to ask the same thing. Please slow down when you're working around them. A few tales of people bypassing cones, forcing people to jump out of the way, and that's destructive. Bear with us. We're working. Offer space to people doing their jobs. Let them do their jobs. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you. Kim Stinson, South Carolina Emergency Management Division.
Thank you, sir. Kim Stinson with State EMD. The State Emergency Operations Center remains at OPCON 1, Operating Condition 1, which is our highest readiness state. The top State Emergency Operations Center priorities right now are maintaining communications, clearing roadways, power restoration, shelter operation, and food and water distribution. We have 10 of our personnel that are deployed to the heaviest impacted counties here in South Carolina, and we continue on a constant basis to closely coordinate with the county emergency management personnel. At the county level, they currently have 10 counties at operating condition 1, which is the highest level of alert, 11 at operating condition number 2, which is the enhanced level of awareness, and 25 are at operating condition 3, which is steady state operations. Their operational focus includes, similar to ours, power restoration, road clearing operations, shelter, and food and water distribution. Damage assessment is ongoing in the affected counties, but we do have some preliminary data. On the residential side, we've got 15 counties that are reporting 519 damaged homes, of which 21 are destroyed and 200 with major damage. Public assistance costs, that's the infrastructure damage and emergency protective measures, are being reported by 36 counties for a total right now of $14 million. And then county governments right today were closed in 14 counties with one county on delay. In the logistics area, our Winsboro warehouse is operational with food, water, and tarps. Contracts for general logistics, transportation, fuel, and food have been activated. So far, we have actioned 450 requests, of which 145 have been completed and 305 are in progress. The most requests are for food, water, fuel, and chainsaws. And under the Emergency Management Assistance Compact, we received 2 search and rescue teams from Louisiana. We also have our public information phone system is operational for residents to call in with any questions, and the number is 1-866-246-0133. On the federal side, an expedited major disaster declaration for South Carolina for Hurricane Helene was received last night. And the expedited declaration includes 13 counties for individual assistance. That's Aiken, Anderson, Bamberg, Barnwell, Cherokee, Greenville, Greenwood, Lexington, Oconee, Newberry, Pickens, Saluda, and Spartanburg counties. Then 12 counties for public assistance, and that's debris and emergency protective measures, were Aiken, Anderson, Bamberg, Barnwell, Cherokee, Greenville, Greenwood, Oconee, Newberry, Pickens, Saluda, and Spartanburg counties. All counties are also eligible for funding under the Hazard Mitigation Grant Program, which funds mitigation projects designed to limit the effects of future disasters, and that can range from wind retrofits to elevating homes. Counties can be added later for both individual or public assistance once damage assessment activities have been completed. Normally, there is a more deliberative process in requesting federal disaster assistance, which involves conducting joint damage assessments with FEMA personnel, which can take several days and sometimes even weeks. As an example, joint damage assessments with FEMA following Tropical Storm Debbie in August took nearly 2 weeks to complete. With Tropical Storm Helene, it was clear that there was significant damage, and so we thought it best to expedite the request to at least start the process to receive federal assistance faster than normal. Accordingly, the expedited request was based on residential damages reported here at the State Emergency Operations Center, storm-related fatalities, heavy power outages, and vulnerability of affected populations. And we do have a federal coordinating officer, Brett Howard, who is here to coordinate that federal assistance as it becomes available. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Major General Ben McCarty, South Carolina National Guard.
Thank you, Governor. Major General Van McCarty, the Military Department of South Carolina. As the Governor initially said, we have over 600 soldiers who are currently deployed for state active duty. We are in the process of bringing on additional personnel to ensure that we have the resources to meet the demands of the state. We continue to have significant aviation assets to support all needs, to include the SC HEART mission that has been uniquely used in this particular case. We, through the Emergency Management Assistance Compact, we EMAC'd two UH-72 helicopters and two CH-47 helicopters to North Carolina. Two of those UH-72s are part of the SC HEART mission, the Helicopter Aquatic Rescue Team. They rescued 20 folks in North Carolina yesterday, so they made a difference. They saved lives. As we continue to bring on forces, we are also in the process of EMAC-ing additional forces to South Carolina from the state of Florida. A unique EMAC for us, we're bringing in an Air Force but Air Guard resource from Florida. It's called a Red Horse Unit. It's a small unit, but it brings a lot of capability as it relates to what we need right now, and that's debris clearing capability. So we look forward to having those soldiers or airmen from Florida tomorrow. We're also in the process of looking to other states to bring in additional resources, and we will adjust those resources as the situation requires. We're also working with our state guard, integrating them with missions for support to the counties. To this point, we have been focusing most of our missions with our engineers to support South Carolina Department of Transportation and ensuring that we can get the state highways back up. We're in the process now of shifting our focus of work from that mission, and we're going to now, focus our work to the counties. We're going to deploy engineering assets to each county. Those counties will have the opportunity through their emergency operations centers to prioritize their needs, and our soldiers there will help them recover as the situation requires. We're in good standing here in South Carolina. We have plenty of resources both in the South Carolina Guard, and we can certainly reach out to other states and to Title 10 to help us in the recovery process. Team South Carolina will get through this. Thank you.
Thank you, Thank you. General Secretary Justin Powell, Department of Transportation.
Thank you, Governor. Justin Powell, Secretary of the South Carolina Department of Transportation. SCDOT is not slowing down, but is in fact speeding up with our recovery from the Tropical Storm Helene. Our workforce is fully engaged and continues its 24-hour operations in response to this. To date, we now have 87 additional DOT and contractor crews that have been moved into the affected area. That's up from 60 crews that were available yesterday. Continue to do that, and we will continue to send additional people and equipment into the affected areas until we get the job done. We ask for the public's patience through this disaster. I encourage motorists when they come across, whether it's a public works crew, a DOT crew, a utility crew, a public safety crew, a National Guard crew, any of those working on the side of the road, slow down, give them their space, make sure that they can do their jobs. We want everyone to get home at the end of the day. At present, we have 480 roads closed across the state, but we have reopened 287 routes so far. As power companies focus more on getting into the distribution side of things, we will begin be able to be reopening more routes as they untangle the power lines that are on the trees that are in the roads. SCDOT is working very closely with the utility providers and assisting them in clearing the trees and so we can get the power grid restored as quickly as possible. Do want to talk a little bit about the water levels on the Congaree and Watery rivers. We see no threat to the bridges there and have been actively monitoring and closely watching that as well as that, but we have no concerns that there is any threat from flooding on those structures. And finally, we're getting the trees out of the roadway quickly. As you travel, you will see piles of debris and trees piling up on the side of the road. Know that we are in the process of activating our debris removal plan, and we'll start working on that in October. Thank you. Thank you, Governor.
Thanks, sir. Director Robert Wood, South Carolina Department of Public Safety.
Good afternoon. Rob Woods, Director of South Carolina Department of Public Safety. I'll just give you an idea as to where we are with regard to the traffic management mission. First of all, our calls for service, and when I say calls for service, what I reference is collisions, assist motorists, blocked roadways. Those have been trending downward over the last couple of days. They peaked on Friday at around 2,300. We got to just over 1,000 on Saturday, and then yesterday it was about 570. During the morning hours, our first shift today, 6 a.m. to around 11 a.m. during those first few hours, we were back to about 120 calls for service. So we're trending back to normal. What that means for us is now we can shift our focus of effort to assisting SLED with law enforcement missions, and that's where our personnel will be primarily concentrating in their efforts. So, for example, we've got 196 personnel from the South Carolina Highway Patrol and State Transport Police assigned statewide right now. 121 of those are in the upstate area, which is where the greatest impact of the storm is. So those folks right now, those officers and troopers, are primarily conducting high-profile law enforcement patrols, but we're also available to assist SLED with specific law enforcement and security missions. Lastly, I would just share this with you. Again, going back to the safety message, roadways in some instances still blocked by trees and in some instances water. Please be aware of that. Avoid those things. Please use extra caution while you're driving. In addition to that, we still have some areas where intersections are not under traffic control or normal traffic control signals. Please be aware, in some instances, we've got law enforcement out there directing traffic. Pay attention to the law enforcement. And as I mentioned the other day, when you come up on an intersection and there's no law enforcement there and there's no traffic signal that's functioning, treat that like you would a four-way stop. So as you're coming up to a stop sign, stop. If there's a vehicle to the right, yield to that vehicle. Thank you.
Thank you, Rick Wood. Chief Mark Keel, SLED.
Mark Keel, SLED Chief. ESF 13, SLED, DNR, PPP, SCDC, and DPS are currently providing 52 agents, officers, or troopers in 10 counties and 4 cities to support sheriff's office and police chiefs with security-related missions. Those counties include Aiken, Cherokee, McCormick, Edgefield, Saluda, Lawrence, Union, Greenwood, Spartanburg, Kershaw counties, the city of North Augusta, Union, Greenwood, and the city of Packlet. In addition, Conway Police Department has 5 officers that will begin assisting Union City tonight. They're in travel status as we speak. ESF 13, again, those agencies I just mentioned, those state agencies, we have staffed additional teams for deployment to additional counties to provide increased law enforcement presence to maintain order and visibility. We're anticipating using an additional 132 law enforcement officers. This will involve the counties of Abbeville County, Cherokee County, Allendale County, Anderson County, Barnwell County, Bamberg County, Edgefield County, Greenville County, Hampton County, Lawrence County, Lexington County, McCormick County, Newberry County, Oconee County, Pickens County, Union County, and Spartanburg County. We're also assisting with food drops and distribution locations to secure those resources until they are distributed out to the citizen. We have all our aviation assets are available for missions or assessments, and we will continue to maintain contact with our law enforcement, local law enforcement partners, and respond to any requests they have for additional services.
Thank you, Chief Keel. Director Emily Farr, LLR.
Thank you, Governor. Emily Farr with the Department of Labor, Licensing and Regulation, here to provide an update on the state's firefighting and search and rescue efforts organized through our Division of State Fire. In response to requests from the counties, our search and rescue and firefighting missions are continuing to support missions in the upstate counties with urban search and rescue teams and fire department resources through firefighter mobilization. As of today, we have 228 personnel assigned throughout the upstate. They are providing access to conduct welfare checks during our search operations. We also have one FEMA team that arrived from California last night. They are operating in Greenville County today. We expect another FEMA team also from California arriving later today that will be operating in Oconee and Pickens counties. I did want to make note of some really important safety notes during this time. Anytime that we see power outages, there's always concerns about generator safety and using candles. So really important messages for those of you using generators or for your neighbors or friends that may be using them. Make sure never to run a generator inside of your home. If you're using a portable generator, having a battery operated or battery backup carbon monoxide alarms in your home if possible. The effects of carbon monoxide poisoning are dizziness, breathlessness, confusion, or loss of consciousness. Be sure not to overload the generator. Before refueling it, shut it down and allow it to cool, then refuel the generator. Try to keep it at least 20 feet from doors, windows, and vent openings into the home, and never use it in an attached garage. For candle safety, if you're using candles, be sure to check your smoke alarms to make sure they're operational. Consider using battery-operated flameless candles if you can, or of course, flashlights. If you are using candles, be sure to put them in a sturdy candle holder and on a flat surface. And as always, do not leave open flame candles unattended. We're working really hard to push this message out as much as we can in partnership with EMD and others, but these are very important safety notes for all of our folks without power. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Farr. State Forester Scott Phillips.
Good afternoon. The Forestry Commission is currently continues to support road clearing operations in the Piedmont of South Carolina. Our incident management team continues to support EMD's points of distribution mission, which is delivering food and water to affected areas within the state. The agency is also working on a damage assessment for South Carolina. We've got airplanes in the air currently looking at what is the damage to our forest in South Carolina. We are implementing a state forester's burn ban effective tomorrow morning. So Tuesday, October 1st at 6 a.m. The purpose of that burn ban is to relieve strain on first responders that are currently out there working in the field. As the governor said a while ago, we need to keep all the players on the field out there. And so we don't need to be pulling away our firefighters from road clearing missions or emergency response to go to fires, debris fires in somebody's yard. We will reevaluate the need for that burn as power and access are restored into the damage affected areas. Thank you.
Thanks, sir. Director Mike Leach, Department of Social Services.
Thank you, Governor. Mike Leach, DSS. As of 2 p.m. today, South Carolina currently has 16 total shelters open, 10 general population shelters, and 6 medical needs shelters open across the state, supporting around 206 individuals currently. We continue to work with Department of Public Health with operation of these sites with Red Cross and a few other organizations. And we continue to work on feeding programs. We have a mass feeding sites currently available in the following areas: Aiken County, which is servicing Aiken, Edgefield, and Barnwell counties, Saluda County, and the southern part of Richland County, Gadsden area. And those are being operated by the Salvation Army. And, you know, just want to thank the communities and churches and businesses that are working with their local communities and the citizens to make sure that there is feeding and water. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Edward Sumo, South Carolina Department of Public Health.
Thank you, Governor. Good afternoon. Dr. Ed Simmons, South Carolina Department of Public Health. First, wanted to give an update on our healthcare facilities. Thanks to great work from our utility partners, all of our hospitals have had power restored and are fully operational and open, so that's very good news. We still have nursing homes and assisted livings and other facilities that are running on generator power. We are working closely with them. All of their patients are being well taken care of. They have adequate food and fuel, and we, again, are checking in on them regularly. From the medical needs standpoint, Director Leach mentioned that we have the medical needs shelters. Those are for people who have medical equipment and need a secure source of electricity to run that medical equipment. If you think you might be needing one of those, please call us at 1-855-472-3432. Again, 855-472-3432. We will work with you to identify what your needs are and then get you to one of our shelters if that's appropriate. I will also note, we know there's a number of people who need medical oxygen, and that has been a challenge. We have secured a supply of medical oxygen, the small bottles, the personal size bottles of those, and are currently transporting that to the upstate in a number of different areas and working with our counties and the medical facilities up there to develop a distribution plan, and you'll be hearing more about that very soon. Finally, just a couple of public health issues to be thinking about. One is food safety. If you have food in a refrigerator or a freezer without power, it's time to throw it out. Please make sure you put it in a secure container so wild animals don't get into it, but that food is no longer safe and unfortunately needs to go. Also, please make sure that if you have standing water that you're able to drain, get rid of that. We're very concerned about mosquitoes and mosquito-borne illness after this storm. The less standing water we have, the less mosquitoes we will have. And finally, if you're working in your yard, you're working to clear debris, be careful of heat illness. The heat index is going to be in the mid-80s in the upstate the next several days. That's certainly hot enough if you're working hard to develop heat illness. Make sure you're drinking water, taking frequent breaks, and if you start to feel overheated, find a cool location to cool off so you don't succumb to heat illness, which can have serious outcomes. With that, sir, thank you very much.
Thank you, Ed. So, Interim Director Myra Reese, South Carolina Department of Environmental Services.
Thank you, Governor. Good afternoon, Myra Reese, Department of Environmental Services. The team at DES have been very laser focused on the following areas of responsibility and priorities, beginning with dams. Our dam safety program is not aware of any significant issues with our state regulated dams because of Helene. We are continuing our post-storm assessments, and as a reminder, we were looking at the dams that were located in counties that received significant rainfall greater than 8 inches, and we identified about 200 dams. The counties they are located is Pickens, Greenwood, Lawrence, Oconee, Abbeville, Aiken, Anderson, Edgefield, and Greenville. We have assessed the condition of about 104 dams. 45 of those we were able to get to the site and have staff assessments. The remaining 59 were self-reports from the dam owners. The concerns with overtopping of dams have greatly diminished. However, debris accumulations in spillways is a concern both now and in weeks to come as runoff from rainfall washes into reservoirs, including limbs and debris. So this is a message to our dam owners. We're asking you to continue monitoring water levels and continue to ensure spillways are clear and free of debris. In addition, you should also monitor for voids in the dams created by fallen trees. If voids are noted or any assistance is needed for our dam owners, please contact our dam safety staff at 803-898-4050. Again, 803-898-4050. We're on call 24 hours. Drinking water, no issues have been reported related to the supply of public drinking water to our citizens. As the governor mentioned, we're aware of a lot of misinformation being spread right now about drinking water and wastewater operations. The governor mentioned the City of Columbia held a press conference earlier today to address those rumors, and we're aware of other utilities working to clarify misinformation as well. I just want to strongly encourage everyone to please get your information directly from the utilities themselves. Please don't rely on hearsay or social media posts unless the social media updates are directly from the utilities themselves. We continue to reach out to drinking water and wastewater systems across the state, especially those in the heavily impacted areas, so that we can monitor their status. And one in particular area is to check on fuel supply status for those that are relying on generator power until permanent power is obtained. We have been in direct communications with many of these systems, down from the largest to the smallest. And they all are currently able to treat and distribute drinking water to their customers. And we're working hard to make sure it stays that way. We do continue to receive notifications of drinking water facilities that are taking precautionary measures to conserve water and in some cases issuing boil water advisories because of low pressure within the system. Please follow information directly from your local drinking water provider for the latest updates. And just as with drinking water, we're aware of a lot of misinformation about facilities operation status on the wastewater side. We have been notified of some sanitary sewer overflows, as you would expect with any storm of this significance, and we will remain in communication with our state's wastewater facilities to provide technical assistance. We're also making sure that those providers understand the circumstances in which they need to issue public notifications about a local sanitary sewer overflow. Debris management, we're communicating with our state partners and with local entities about debris management sites, and that we will approve alternative debris sites as needed so you can get the debris off of your property. Coastal impacts, our Bureau of Coastal Management has been made aware of a small amount of docks in the Beaufort area that were damaged. We're working with the owners of those structures. We have teams out today assessing for any other beachfront structures in our coastal communities. And a reminder to private well owners, we know that there are a lot of folks who rely on private wells for their drinking water, and when you don't have power, you don't have access to drinking water. We also know that your well could have been impacted by flood waters, and so we just want to encourage you to contact our private well hotline at 1-888-761-5989. Again, that's 1-888-761-5989 for guidance and information about how you can have your well water tested and your well disinfected. In closing, just a reminder about flood water. We want to continue to remind all South Carolinians to avoid flood waters and use extreme caution around them. As you're aware, there are many harmful things that could have an impact on your health, and we'd like you to be reminded to take precautions. Thank you.
Thank you, Maurice. Director Marcia Adams, South Carolina Department of Administration.
Yes, good afternoon. Marcia Adams, South Carolina Department of Administration. And I'm going to update you today on donated goods. And I first want to say thank you to all the citizens in the state and those outside of the state for their many offers of assistance. We're continuing to work with counties to determine their needs for donated goods and volunteers, and just want to thank everyone for what they are doing to help South Carolina. Because donations of products for disaster relief require transportation and warehousing, the most effective donation is usually a monetary donation. charitable organizations assisting South Carolina victims can use those donations to purchase, locally if possible, the exact items those victims need to recover. We are requesting that all monetary donations, food, or other donated goods be sent directly to South Carolina voluntary organizations who are assisting our state with a disaster response. A list of those organizations can be found at SCEMD.org/recovery/volunteer-and-donate. For people interested in volunteering, you can also visit that same website where there is a link to volunteersc.org to register to volunteer. Many volunteer opportunities require specialized training, and we want to ensure that all volunteers are safe during the response and recovery activities. Please do not self-deploy, as unexpectedly showing up at a location will create an additional burden for first responders. As public officials and disaster relief organizations identify specific needs, if you are registered, you will be contacted. Again, thank you for all of the offers for assistance. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you, Mayor. Well, that's a lot of information. Does anybody have a question? As you can see, we've got a great team. Team South Carolina is a great team.
Governor.
Yes, sir.
So on Wednesday evening, about 6:50, the National Weather Service in Columbia issued advisory that we're going to get tropical storm winds here in the Midlands, indicating we're going to get some stronger winds further west. But you still didn't do any kind of media briefing ahead of that on Thursday. Why not do any media briefing on Thursday when you have some people saying they feel like they weren't had a chance to get prepared for the storm?
We did issue the declaration on Wednesday, emergency declaration. It got a lot of publicity and a lot of information, and also we had a number of press events around the state at which these questions came up, and we recited all that at those.
I actually had a question for the utilities. I know that there's been a lot of grid resiliency work done ahead of the storm. As this came in, we saw more damage done to some of the high voltage transmission lines. I was just wondering, what we actually knew about the vulnerability of the system heading into this, how this impacts ongoing work to improve that?
Well, we always say we work 365 days to prepare for this, and that includes vegetation management. The transmission lines that you speak of is regulated by the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, the same folks that regulate Lake Murray. And we clear those lines from one side of that right away to another. We are under extreme rules and regulations. If we have a tree that falls into a power line, if it doesn't come off that right of way, then we're subject to fines and censure by that organization. So we have a team of arborists and foresters that stay on that at all times. You need to understand we do a lot of work where we put in steel poles. Steel poles are resilient of winds up to about 150 miles per hour. And on our system, as I won't speak for the Duke system, but I can speak for Jimmy's system, we have voltages of 230,000 and 115,000 volts. We have also what we call sub-transmission, which is kind of transmission distribution is 46,000 volts. Some of that is wood poles. Wood poles, you get a 70, 75 mile per hour winds, which is what we had, you're going to have problems. That's kind of like the same thing with the distribution. So that's basically where we've got trouble. We don't have it where we kind of did our grid resiliency with the steel poles, and we replace those as we go in, as the state grows, and as we go in there and have issues. So that's a 365 days. Some lady sent me an email saying, why didn't y'all go out and make the system safe before the hurricane came? And it's just, that's impossible to do. We're doing it every day with the work that we do. Some of the folks that complain the loudest about the lights being out are some ones that complain the loudest when we go in there to do the tree trimming. So we just, that's just human nature, and we accept that, and we understand that, but we're always working to inspect, patrol, and maintain both our transmission and distribution assets, as well as our dams that we use for hydro generation and our power plants.
Keller covered a lot of ground there, and very similar for Duke Energy. At the highest voltages, we go up to 500 kV. At the lowest level, we have 44 kV that you called sub-transmission. Those highest voltage lines fared well. But the level of destruction that we're seeing in the upstate is a level that we haven't seen. Governor, we were in Greenville yesterday. I appreciate you coming and touring that and hosting a media event there where Senator Graham said, you know, his whole life in the upstate, he's never seen destruction like that. And so the investments that we've made certainly have been helpful, but the level of destruction is just beyond something that you can harden a grid for.
Gotcha. And I know that you mentioned that this work has been ongoing, that you guys are hamstrung by a lot. Did you anticipate that something like this could have happened ahead of time? I was just kind of curious as far as, like, I mean, hindsight being 2020, obviously, but.
Yeah, I mean, there's always preparation for any kind of natural disaster. You know, it's interesting, in the upstate, what I usually lose sleep over and think about most is an ice storm. We've had those before that caused this level of destruction. And so we do what we can to build infrastructure. You know, some of our system is underground, some of it is not, obviously. We have a system that's been built up over many decades. But we'll continue to evaluate and learn as we will from this storm.
Yes.
Governor, you mentioned that you spoke with President Biden yesterday.
Well, I didn't speak with him. His message was one of a number.
Okay, and what specifically are the feds providing for?
That's what we're just talking about.
Yeah.
He referred to that.
To the declaration and how FEMA has been working with us. And I had spoken with Dina Criswell, the FEMA administrator, a day or two prior to that. He left a message. I was busy, couldn't answer the phone. So I called him back and left a message for him. So I expect we'll probably talk before long. But he's good about staying in touch. And FEMA has always been a big help. And we have, where is our man?
Where? Right here, sir. Right here, right.
Come on over, let him take a look at you. Tell him what you're doing, please.
Okay, sure, be glad to. Hi, I'm Brett Howard. I've been appointed as the federal coordinating officer for Hurricane Helene. Currently, as you heard through this, we've got two USAR teams, that one is employed, one is on the way. That encompasses about 90 personnel for both, 45, that are on the ground. I've got staff that are inbound to start getting out into the communities that are impacted by this disaster, that have the declaration in those counties. We need them to start registering. I have an IMAT team, and I need to give you numbers for that. I don't think anybody has asked, so if I could, I'll get to that in just a second. I have an incident management assistance team that is helping me bring in the federal resources the state and the survivors are going to need as we transition from response to recovery, as the power comes back on and repairs start being made. We also have mobile registration intake centers getting ready to be in these areas to help. With that, we're helping with public health on oxygen bottles, anything that the state really requires and needs that they can't really, through their robust contracting system. And many of you were here during Debbie, and I talked at length about the state and their preparedness, and you have heard from all of the governor's staff about how well they do and how many contracts they have in place. But I do want to make sure we get this message out to the survivors. And also my thoughts and FEMA's thoughts and prayers are with those that lost loved ones in this, mm-hmm. and also those that have lost homes and property in this too. So there's three ways to really get in touch with FEMA. If you're in one of those declared counties, the web is disasterassistance.gov. You can call the 1-800 number, 1-800-621 3362, 1-800-621-FEMA, or you can use the FEMA app on your phone, either iPhone or Android. The easiest and most efficient way to do it is on the web. That will get you registered really quick. There's no waiting on a phone call or anything like that. And those, we need to get people registered so we can start get them started in their recovery, to start purchasing things that they need to do to either repair their home, have somewhere to stay, and things like that. That answer your question, ma'am?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Governor.
Thanks, sir.
Yeah, a couple other items. One is on the public assistance side, FEMA pays 75% of those costs, and the state has to pick up the other 25%. And so it's so important that we have all that documentation from the local level, to identify the facility or the damage and get that documentation in terms of, you know, how much it's going to cost to repair that. That's extremely important on that end of it. On the individual assistance side, FEMA picks up a lot of that themselves, and I think it's about $80,000 max you could get right now in terms of IA per individual, the ONA.
Oh, you're
needs.
Combining the two programs?
Yeah. Yeah,
other needs and
yeah, combined. So you could get a potential of $80,000. Most people don't get that much. Half of it is for basically housing, and the other half is for what they call other needs assistance, and that could be medical bills, repairing or replacing some of your furniture and that sort of thing. So they're bringing a lot to bear, like right now, in terms of oxygen and the federal teams and all that. But at the end of the day, what they really bring to South Carolina is reimbursement for many of these costs, both at the public level and at the government level as well. But documentation is extremely important, and that starts at the local level.
I think false documentation, I think, draws a penalty, a criminal penalty.
We should be correct about it.
More questions?
Yes. So when it comes to the daily assistance, we're seeing a lot of, you know, private citizens offering water, places to charge phones, take showers, things like that. Other than shelters, is the state offering any other places to do that? Just kind of get water, food, anything like that?
Well, several people have talked about these points of distribution that we're supplying food and water to the counties. All this is managed at the local level, and so they ask us to provide the equipment, in this case the commodities, and that's shipped in, and then we work with them in terms of staffing and that sort of thing. So it's kind of an on-demand system. We've got supplies at our Winnsboro warehouse, and if they need it, we will ship it.
Okay, and that's, like you said, so like county administration would request those things?
Yeah, well, the emergency each county has an emergency management office that does similar to what we do here at the state, in managing the emergency in terms of the operation and the logistics and the recovery piece of it. So we work with them.
Well, Governor, sort of the same question for the schools that may have lost food and items. Who picks up the tab for that?
School.
That's a good question. Most of the schools get their funding for their food through USDA. And I'm not exactly sure how they work that, but I think they'll just replace it normally. And I don't know if anybody else has a better thought on that or not, but not seeing any. But
Governor, can we get a description of what kind of assets were pre-positioned before the storm, and where were they pre-positioned, especially as we hear about crews coming in from out of state to assist our electric utilities?
Yeah, they're coming from California, Florida, Mississippi, I think Alabama.
But what was
the pre-positioned ahead of time?
I don't recall the exact number we had in the beginning, but I will say at the first media briefing we talked about 18 states all the way to Canada. We had crews coming in. That number increases literally as we speak. For the Duke Energy system, we also serve parts of Florida, parts of the Midwest. This storm came right up through Florida, through South Carolina, North Carolina, and into Indiana, Ohio, Kentucky that we serve. We're wrapping up restoration outside of the Carolinas. Those areas weren't hit with I think Rob, you called it the dirty side of the storm, and didn't face the level of destruction. So we're starting to collapse in and move crews from Florida and the Midwest. So that number will continue to increase.
I spoke to the governor on Sunday. That's way back before the storm. Way back when it was still supposed to go through Atlanta instead of the I-Pass and over Augusta. On Monday, we sent a message out to all of our storm coordinators within the company. Let's go ahead, take care of your families at home, and let's get ready to work, because we're probably going to be impacted by this storm in some way. At that time, we said Cat 3 is what we were anticipating. We put our storm team together and had our first call on Wednesday. We went into storm mode and opened up our storm center on Thursday. That's when we start communicating with Mr. Bateman. I had my first call with him the Friday before, when I called him and said, hey, I think this one's coming. I think we're going to have some mutual assistance. And then we put a request in with Southeastern Electric Exchange, just like Duke Energy did, and we asked for resources to come here to the state. I mean, a lot of these social rumor lies that we released linemen to go work in Florida, which is absurd. We bring resources here. The problem is because this storm was so large and it was covering Florida, could have gone all the way to Alabama, didn't know where it was going to go, none of those utilities within close driving proximity were releasing crews. And neither were we, and neither did we. And then once the storm hit, and it was so impactful from Alabama all the way and up into Tennessee, it took a while for these resources to come here. This was an unusual storm. Usually storms come in and hit us direct. They come into the Gulf, go across Florida, and then they impact us as they go up the East Coast. All that energy goes into the Atlantic Ocean and we get the rain. And you've covered those hurricanes. This one was different. It shot right up as a Category 4. It had 350 miles of what it impacted as far as it spreading out. And Tallahassee is 292 miles from Columbia. So here we are. And Aiken's even closer. And Greenville and Spartanburg even closer. And that's why you got the impact that you did. So if I go back to when we started preparing, it was Friday a week for this storm to come. From that regard, we had the resources in place. We had people's minds and hearts trained on what was to come. We started stocking up our material for what was to come. And we put this entire, what the government refers to as Team South Carolina, in place. And Dominion Energy is just proud to play a small part in all of that because it works. And it worked in this storm as well.
Yeah, I think what you got to keep in mind is we were tracking the storm ahead of time. We had started our coordinations. We had started doing things at DOT in terms of moving equipment, moving personnel. So in anticipation of the forecast, we had moved personnel into Pickens, Oconee, Anderson, Greenville counties ahead of the storm. We put our crews on 24-hour operations. So they were there. They didn't have to go to the yards and cut their way in. Our crews were cutting their way out, and so they were immediately responding as soon as those 35-mile-an-hour winds came down and started working from there. And then as any storm happens, you've got to be able to adjust to the conditions of what actually happens. And in this case, we had to do that, and that's a, you know, we've been able to surge because we had those resources prepped and ready to go into the zone. Yes.
Justin, do you have any sense on when the roads might be cleared?
So I think what we're really following is our, you know, the power companies are kind of the main linchpin in this whole process for us. So one of the big things for us is if it's tangled up in a power line, the tree is over there, we got to wait for them to come in, ground it for us. And so we've been working very closely with them. In fact, today is a good example in the North Augusta area. Dominion and our crews were working hand in glove. We're operating the chainsaws going from there. So I would say is I think as the power company is looking towards the end of this week, I think we'll be following right behind from there.
Yes, South Carolina Guards also began to monitor the storm early on after the governor issued his executive order. We brought on 75 soldiers and high water vehicles, the LMTVs, anticipating this to be initially a water event where we may have the need to send in personnel to rescue people that may have been stranded. Very consistent with what we've done in the past with Tropical Storm Debbie and on the coastal region. So we went to that degree to get ready. Immediately after the storm hit, we realized that we had a different storm to contend with. We had already brought in some. Our engineers that are in the headquarters at the 122nd Engineer Battalion in Edgefield immediately began to do what we call immediate response. They had to be able to dig themselves out so they could begin to poise themselves for the missions that they have been conducting now since then. So we leaned ahead, but the storm, as you've already heard, was a lot more impactful than what we had initially anticipated, but it was a planning process based upon what we knew that we enacted upon.
Do you have any idea about cell phone towers and how many of those are down, and if that's just power related or if some of these towers need to be rebuilt? Any telecom information here?
No, Andrew Bateman, Office of Regulatory Staff. I do not know how many cell phone towers are down. That's something I can look into and get that information to you, though.
Marsha Adams, South Carolina Department of Administration. I don't know the number of towers, but I do know the percentage of cell phone outages statewide is 13% today. That's down from 18% yesterday, with the highest concentration of those outages in Abbeville, McCormick, and Lawrence counties.
Are we seeing any gas shortages anywhere, and if so, in what counties?
Hey, thank you. Andrew Bateman, ORS. We've been in frequent communication with gas suppliers throughout the state. Our contact at Colonial Pipeline tells us that there is not a gas shortage. There are some stations that are out of power currently. I think right now, probably a good resource for folks to use would be gasbuddy.com. You can download the app or get on the website, and it'll indicate to you which gas stations are open and actually indicate the prices.
Governor, Clemson's widely criticized for playing their game on Saturday. What do you think they should have done?
That is a good question for Clemson. Any more?
So, I mean, another hindsight question. Like we have all been saying, this storm took a different path than a lot of storms. Looking back on this with what we know now, is there anything that the state would have done differently? Or what have you learned from this?
One thing we've learned is that it'd be nice to have a lot of power lines buried, but that is expensive. Another thing we've learned is that this is Mother Nature that came in this time, but Mother Nature is not an enemy. But we do have enemies. This country has enemies around the world. And this has demonstrated how interconnected and how fragile our system really is. So we need to be sure to harden that as well. But we always plan for the worst case scenario because you never know what's going to happen. And that's as you've heard, that's what we did this time. Sometimes we're lucky and the storm will go someplace that was not predicted. That is, we thought it might be coming at us, and it veered off. Wasn't as strong when it got here because it went across land. But other times, there are things that were not predicted, like some of the flooding in 2015 and the dams breaking. That was not predicted, but it certainly happened. I don't know if Hugo was predicted to be as strong as it was, but it certainly was very, very strong. But again, we anticipate the worst and hope for the best, and sometimes the main predictors are out in Colorado. I think the University of Colorado, is that where it is?
Yes,
and they I mean, that's Colorado State.
Yes, sir.
That they you can see their predictions. I mean, it looks like a plate of spaghetti sometimes with all these different routes. And so we watch all that and try to make the right decision. But generally, What we urge people to do, I'm getting back to part of another question, is get your information from official sources, because there's so many rumors. Some of them we addressed today. There'll be more coming around tomorrow. But your regular, your TV stations, your established TV stations, for example, those are good sources of information. And in this case, they were wall to wall watching this storm and trying to anticipate where it was going. So that's the good kind of information to watch. And also the Emergency Management Division has a brochure that's given out at what grocery stores is it? Where is it?
Yeah.
Here
it is. The Hurricane Guide?
Yeah.
Kim Stenson, State EMD. Yeah, the Hurricane Guide is widely distributed. It's on our website at sceemd.org. It's on our Emergency Manager app that you can download. And it's available at Welcome Centers and Walgreens and Coastal DMVs.
And it is an excellent source of what to do if this, that, or the other happens. And we got them at the house. I urge everybody to get a copy of that. It's good.
Two more questions if you'll have them.
When it comes to, you mentioned burying power lines. Is that something, do you see more talks about that infrastructure change
yes.
happening in the future?
Yes, Lindsey Graham brought it up yesterday in Lessons Learned. There's some other states, I think, that are municipalities that have thought of that. Some of them are doing it. It's very expensive depending on where you are. But we've been trying to get some buried in downtown Columbia, but very expensive. Maybe this may help a little bit. But in some states, they, again, in thinking ahead, lessons learned, some states, I think Florida, to get a building permit, if you're a gas station or something like that, you have to have a generator, have to have generator power. For cases like this, you can see if we, and usually the private market will take care of that, because people want customers to come in if they know that their gas station will be pumping, and that's a good thing. But that's something that I think some of the businesses might want to consider as well. They require it by law in Florida. I don't know if we'll do that here, but it would be a good thing to do.
Last question.
Roughly how many miles of line do we have there above ground?
Wouldn't you know, Joe would ask. That's a good question.
For Dominion Energy, 3,500 miles of transmission, 26,000 miles of distribution. And I will say about the undergrounding, it's expensive, it is expensive, and if customers are going to pay for it, or you're going to put an unfair burden on some South Carolinians that maybe are unable to pay, the way it works for us, we have it in our franchise agreement with municipalities and a matching program so that they can go out and put some of the lines underground. You've seen it in the Vista here in Columbia. You've seen it going up towards Columbia College up North Main, and it's been put to use. Go down and look behind the Capitol on South Main. It's another example of it, and it works from that standpoint. I will also say that you'll go out there, and the people that, whose lights will come on the last will be people with underground power, where the tree roots have uprooted that underground cable and has it in the air, and you'll see it. Or where the tree has come down on top of a switchgear or a pad-mounted transformer. So you always, as the governor said, you just got to take it in balance and see where are the best places, how you can distribute it, and how you can best pay for it.
I was just going to say, my team can get you that information. I don't know exactly how much underground.
Is that, you want to know how much underground and how much?
How much
here
would need to be buried?
Yeah. To bury all of it?
How much is above ground that, in theory, we need to...
Thousands of miles, as you would expect. But in Horry County, Georgetown County, we are working with the communities in each of those areas where they contribute a certain amount of dollars. We match those dollars, and we have systematically been undergrounding at the beach levels now for a number of years. So we're starting to see the value of that investment. But as Keller and Mike have both said, it's an incredibly expensive process, and so we're doing it slowly so that we can keep energy affordable and yet reliable.
And another point is, that is expensive, but what is this that we're doing right now? This is fairly expensive as well. Yes, sir, go ahead.
If you'll let me. For the cooperatives, we do have 1,000 miles of transmission, but we just tapped the interstates that our peers own, and about 79,000, 80,000 miles. But some places have done underground, and I would make sure everyone knows that. Keller mentioned it, Hilton Head Island, all underground. Places that get hit normally are putting power lines underground. This, again, was a spot that was unexpected, and on the dirty side of the hurricane, it is just really tough. It's crazy expensive to put power lines underground.
Well, y'all, thank you very much. We're not out of it yet. We have a lot of work. I'd ask you everyone to be patient and realize that this great team we have is working to get things back humming and keep your neighbors, friends in your prayers. Thank you.